William Booth, an old man in his 75th year, he has had the courage and determination to inaugurate an entirely new method of campaigning. In the autumn of 1904, he used a motor car to tour from one end of the kingdom to the other. During this first motor campaign, a distance of 1,250 miles was covered. Imagine what this meant in these primitive cars for a man in his 70s. People who disapproved of these methods. But on the whole, the imagination of the world was struck with sympathy and approval that this very old man should adopt the latest invention of science at the end of his life's work. Inspired by love of humanity. Campaigning by motor car soon became one of the general's established methods. In vehicles like these, he journeyed throughout Canada, Scotland, and Wales. The going was not always without mishaps. A puncture in those days was apparently not very easy to deal with. People belonging to the lost land of the East End would gather here. William Booth's commanding figure and forceful words immediately challenged attention, and godless, heedless crowds packed the tent despite the fact that roughs slashed it with knives and on more than one occasion cut the guy ropes, bringing it down upon those within. But winter came, cold, chilly winds blew in through rents in the tent onto the people, and the congregation declined. Other meeting places had to be found. Meetings were held in theatres on Sunday nights, and various other buildings were used as a temporary expedient. In 1864 came the turning point in the mission's history. A beer shop known as the Eastern Star was acquired and converted into permanent headquarters. This picture from the cover of the Report of the Christian Mission in 1867 shows this building after the conversion. It provides also the first evidence of the use of flags. The flag flying over the building may be said to be the forerunner of the flags used in the Salvation Army today. A notice on the front of the building throws interesting light on the activities of William Booth at this time. He was, by now, a general superintendent of the mission. Inside, a large room built for an American bowling saloon seated 300 people and was crowded to the doors every evening of the week. By 1869, the mission had a number of branches, but it still had no central hall. A building known as the People's Market had recently been erected on the Whitechapel Road, where cheap provisions of all kinds were sold. The venture was not successful, and William Booth appealed for funds to purchase the property and turn it into a mission hall. In due course, this was done. The shop at the front was operated as a soup kitchen. It was characteristic of William Booth that he insisted on a wooden floor for the mission hall instead of an asphalt one, saying, "Poor people feel the cold quite as much, if not more, than do the rich people. No one gets a blessing if they have cold feet, and nobody ever got saved while they had toothache." In the year 1878, what appeared to be a small incident developed into a momentous happening. The front page of the printer's proof of the mission's 1878 report and appeal bore the words, "The Christian Mission under the superintendence of the Reverend William Booth, is a volunteer army. William Booth was studying the proof in his bedroom with Bramwell and Railton. Bramwell, on seeing the phrase volunteer army, said, "Here, I'm no volunteer, I'm a regular or nothing." At this, William Booth looked at his son, took up his pen, and struck out the word volunteer. For it, he substituted salvation. This was the first appearance of the description in Salvation Army. Out of that conference, and by the hand of William Booth, came the inspiration which gave the organization a striking name, wholly descriptive of its purpose and character, the appropriateness of which has never been questioned. With a change of name officially confirmed in 1878, a military form of government was adopted. A natural step was the adoption of a military uniform also. At first, as this picture of the Exeter Corps in 1880 shows, there was a great variety in the styles worn by the various individuals. In 1883, William Booth, now beginning to be universally referred to as the General, called attention to the greatly increased value of uniform with every fresh growth of the Army's publicity. Old photographs have been preserved too, showing how music was taken up by the soldiers of the Army during the 1880s. Here is the Fry family, famous among early Army musicians who formed the first band. The General, who had always been a great lover of music, wrote at this time, "Music is to the soul what wind is to a ship, blowing her onwards in the direction in which she is steered." Typical of the time is the concert choir. Vocal music, too, underwent a fundamental change at this time, the word hymn being dropped in favor of the term Salvation Army song. Members of this speaking, singing, and praying brigade include Emma and Evangeline Booth. With the advent of bands and singing brigades on a wide scale, music had become so important that the General established a musical department. Richard Slater with a violin, Henry Hill and Fred Fry, the first staff, were charged with the job of making the best use of music in the army. This drawing shows the Whitechapel band on parade. On the 20th of August 1912, William Booth, God's soldier, laid down his sword. He lay in state in the Congress Hall, London. For the last time, he leaves the Army headquarters in Queen Victoria Street. Through the streets of London, his funeral procession passed, through the city of which he was freeman. Flags of nations invaded by the army were carried proudly at the head of the column. The whole traffic of this metropolis was arrested by one of the densest multitudes that ever thronged this thoroughfare. As the carriage passed the National House, the Lord Mayor of London saluted the column. Men and women from the ranks of the Salvation Army, specially selected to represent their comrades, walked behind their promoted leader, who had taught them to give their lives ministering to the poorest, the lowliest, and the lost.
You are enjoying yourself. The Salvationist is the friend of happiness, making heaven on earth is our business. Serve the Lord, that is one of our favorite mottos. So I am pleased that you are pleased. But amidst all your joys, don't forget the sons and daughters of misery. Do you ever visit them? Come away and let us make a call or two. Here is a home. Christian family, they eat and drink and sleep and kiss and die in faith chamber. Skeleton and Dr. Tobble. Void of furniture. Wifeless skeleton. Children in rags. Father mouth-beating the victim of his neglect. Here are the unemployed, wandering about seeking work and finding none. Yonder are the wretched criminals, cradled in crime, passing in and out of the prison, all the time. There are the daughters of shame, deceived and wronged and ruined, traveling down the dark incline to an early grave. There are the children, fighting in the gutters, going hungry and cool, growing up to think their parents' dreams. Brought it all on themselves, you say? Perhaps so. But that does not excuse our assisting them. You don't demand a certificate of virtue before you drag the drowning creature out of the water, nor the assurance that a man has paid his rent before you deliver him from the burning building. But what shall we do? Content ourselves by thinking of him, offering a prayer, or giving a little good advice? No. 10,000 times no. We will pity them, feed them, reclaim them, employ them. Perhaps we shall fail with many, quite likely. But our business is to help them all the same. And that in the most practical, economical, and Christ-like manner. So let us haste to the rescue, for the sake of our own peace, the poor wretches themselves, Venus, children, and the Savior of us all. Withdraw myself with the means, and as there is nothing like the present, who in this company will lend a hand by taking up my gullet? Some time ago, a steamer with a number of gold miners on board was seen approaching San Francisco. The voyage had been delightful, and all were in high peace at the near prospect of home. Suddenly, a fierce gale drove the vessel onto a rock, and the captain announced that she was sinking while in boat. On the deck, a sunburnt miner was bustling around his wasted golden savings. When a little lassie of 7 summers came along, and looking up into his face, asked the question, "Please, sir, can you swim?" "Yes," said the miner, "I reckon so." "Then please, sir, ask the child with tearful eyes, will you save me?" Quick as thought, the miner saw that he could not save the child and his money as well, but he soon decided, and overboard went the gold. "Creep up, my darling, put your arms round me neck tight." In the next moment, he was strapping the little leg where a few seconds before he had been fastening the gold. Then, plunging into the billow, swam and swam until a big wave landed him on the shore. They bore him to a cottage, and opening his eyes, he asked, "Where am I?" When the same little form, creeping up his bosom, kissed him on both cheeks and said, "Please, sir, I'm so glad you saved me." All around you on the waste waters of life, in their poverty, miseries and sin, the people are seeking. Will you help them? Give me the money, pride or self, bar the way overboard with it. Put your trust in God, throw your arms round the perishing, and swim, until by and by, when the kindly hand of death lands you on the golden shore, the spirit whom you are saved shall bear you away on their snowy wings to the feet of your Lord, and say, 'This is the man, this is the woman who saved me.'" On the shores of the Mexican Gulf, a large city had been built, dangerously near high water mark. One day, a mighty tidal wave rolled over it, drowning 10,000 people at a stroke. A community of devoted young women living on the outskirts of the city heard the shrieks of the drowning people and rushed to the rescue, saving many of the unfortunate creatures from their doom. But when the lowering clouds, the growling thunder, and the moaning sea threatened another storm, they fled, agreeing that their work for the day was done. But one girl, specially concerned for the children, said, I'm going to have another turn. No, Mary, her comrades replied, if you go again, you'll come back no more. But, said Mary, the little ones are perishing, and if I refuse to save them, their wailing will haunt my dying pillow. So with a coil of rope round her arm, Mary went out again into the storm, but she came back no more. And when they searched for the dead among the wreckage, they found Mary with an infant in each arm, and seven little children tied together with the rope, one end of which was fastened round her waist. Can't you see Mary dragging her little procession along, when a sudden gust of wind blows her over and the waters drown her where she falls? I shall meet Mary and her little flock in heaven. The Salvation Army's out on the wild waste waters of the world. Our arms are full of children, and thousands of helpless creatures are being borne along by her in safety on earth to earth and blessedness in heaven. Still she wants to do far more, but she's short of rope, and knowing that there must be a good deal of that material unused in these parts, may I ask my friends to send a little along, and thereby earn the blessing of God, the thanks of those ready to perish, and the gratitude of the general.
If thou hast run with them, and they have wearied thee, then hail Falcon, horses, and is in the land of feet, where in darkness they wearied thee, that I'll do in the swelling of yours. Dear comrade, look up, for the joy is set before thee, and haste on thy way to the region of glory. A crown and a kingdom thy fate may discover. Thy troubles are great, but they soon will be over. For Jesus hath suffered thy soul to deliver, and open thy passage through Jordan's dark river. Christ is a sure help to the children of Zion. But if thou hast any false props to rely on, thy soul is deluded. Think what thou art doing. Oh, cast them away, ere they sing eager to ruin. For none but Jehovah has power to deliver, and bear up thy soul in the midst of the river.
I am glad you are enjoying it. The Salvationist is the friend of happiness. Making heaven on earth is our business. Serve the Lord with gladness is one of our favorite mottos. So I am pleased that you are pleased. But amidst all your joys, don't forget the sources of misery. Do you ever visit them? Come away and let us make a call or two. Here is a home, steeped in family. They eat and drink and skip and sit and die in the same chamber. There is a drunken hovel, void of furniture, wife of skeleton, children in rags, father mouthing the victims of his nailing. Here are the unemployed, wandering about seeking work and finding none.
If thou hast run with the footmen, and they have wearied thee, then how canst thou contend with all this? And if in the land of peace, wherein darkness sits, they wearied thee, then how wilt thou do in the swelling of dawn? Dear comrade, look up to the joy set before thee, and haste on thy way to the region of glory. A crown and a kingdom thy face may discover. Thy troubles are great, but they soon will be over. For Jesus hath suffered thy soul to deliver, and opened thy passage through Jordan's dark river. Christ is a sure help to the children of Zion. But if thou hast any false prop to rely on, thy soul is deluded. Think what thou art doing. Oh, cast them away, ere they sing thee to ruin. For none but Jehovah has power to deliver, and bear up thy soul in the midst of the river. The clouds gather blackness, the night is fast coming, the river swells high, and the billows are foaming. On what wilt thou lean when thy strength is all wasted? thy reeds will all fail, and thy hope will be blasted. Oh, cry unto Jesus, thy soul to deliver, and bear up thy spirit when crossing the river. But in thy true character am I mistaken? Hast thou in that folly thy Savior forsaken? Oh, come again to him for peace and for pardon, for soon thou must sink in the swellings of Jordan. Thy soul from all danger he then will deliver, and nothing shall harm thee in crossing the river. But if on his mercy thy soul is relying, thou hast nothing to fear, neither living nor dying. The footmen and horses shall fall down before thee, and Jordan shall open thy back to glory. And when thou art landed safe over the river, we'll sing of salvation forever and ever. Fire of olives.
This is a typical London scene in perhaps 1904 or 5, showing a Salvationist meeting assembling outside a public house. Let us catch another glimpse of this world, half a century ago, in movement. This scene shows traffic outside the Mansion House in the City of London. Among the earliest motion pictures of the Army's activities that have been preserved are some scenes of the International Congress in London in the year 1904. Coming out of the Congress meeting are some of the thousands who took part. The hall used was a temporary building in the Strand, specially erected for this purpose. A great expansion had taken place since the first Congress 20 years before. Years of consolidation in Britain and tremendous expansion in the many other countries that had been invaded by the Army in those 2 decades. The General, accompanied by Commissioners Cadman, Pollard and Kitching, goes to the saluting base for the great march past. This took place at the Crystal Palace. The General acknowledged contingent after contingent from all parts of the world. To William Booth, taking the salute with such vigorous enthusiasm, the International Congress was an event of great importance, for he believed in associating all the races of the earth together in a common religious enthusiasm.
This ends the 10 segments of William Booth and the beginning of the Salvation Army, both audio and the audio from the 5 short films that are available. This is brought to you by School of Prayer, Peter John Parisi, also known as Brian Dean. This is not copyrighted, of course, so please feel free to make as many copies as you desire. May God bless you.